morning. Welcome to worship, all of you who are in the sanctuary and all who are joining us via Armstrong Cable and on Facebook. It is good we're here, and wherever you are, it's good you're here. On this, the first Sunday of August, we usually, in our usual way, celebrate communion. We have decided as a worship committee, not quite yet, and I know it is something we long for. I really miss the sacrament. And some other churches are doing it. You know, that's what I hear also. Some other churches are celebrating communion. Well, hopefully soon, right? We are working on finding a way to do it in a way that is safe and meaningful. So know that that is something that will come back up with the worship committee here in August. Over these last 5 months, we have been very intentional and very responsive to the situation, both in our own community and around the nation, and we continue to do so. We are in, as I have said to a number of people in meetings, we're building the plane while flying it. And I have thought often in this last few months about, of all people, of Orville and Wilbur Wright, who built the plane while flying it. They were brothers, of course, who had this great vision that humans could fly, that there could be something that would carry us. So it's having that big vision and also having the specifics. They worked tirelessly on the most minute aspects of how the wings would be set and how the motor would, the engine would work and what kind of, you know, air pressure and what's the, they were persistent. And I feel like that's what we're working on here at Stone. We are building the plane while flying it. We're working on the specifics while embracing the vision that we can be a congregation that meets in person and has a connection outside of the sanctuary. So thanks. Thanks for coming aboard, right? You're flying the friendly skies of Stone Church right now. With that, you know, I have updated you along the way about what has happened here in terms of our technology and communications committee. That was formed, oh gosh, now probably 3 months ago. Tyson Johnston agreed to be the chairperson of it. On that committee serving is Jen Ashbaugh, Patty Brown, who is our office administrator, Carolyn Turnbull, who has managed both our website and our Facebook page for many, many years, Andy Lawler and Derek Lee, both who bring professional IT experience to this committee. While we're working out the specifics of this work together, we are remembering and keeping this before us, again, as this congregation here and as the broader community who joins us. This is who we say we are, right? This is who we say that we are at Stone Church, compelled by God's love. And you'll notice that comes up in another place here. Compelled by God's love, Stone United Methodist Church is an inclusive community of faith, meeting people where they're at, connecting them to Christ and one another, and helping them live as disciples of Jesus Christ. That's always before us. We are doing our very best to connect with people, to meet them where they are, and then help us stay connected to one another and to Christ so that we can grow as disciples. That is our collective work. In order for this to happen, we'll continue to nurture one another in person, and we are very blessed to have already had on staff Jen Ashbaugh, who for 4 years has been our CYF person, 5 years, has been our director of Children, Youth, and Family Ministries, who in a very short amount of time, and I mean like 3 days, was able to transition from that position to a new position that was approved by staff parish and then by church council to be our director of online ministries. What we realized going through this spring with all these moving parts, that we needed someone like me, who was the pastor of the church, that would continue to care for all of us collectively as best as I can, and that we also needed one who had both the faith perspective and the skill set to enable us to maintain an online presence that would help. We still have tons of volunteers, and thank you to everyone who's volunteering, by the way. But we knew that a paid staff person would allow the volunteers to do their work without such a heavy burden. So, July 1, Jen stepped away from CYF to be our Director of Online Ministries. I do not know, in talking to the conference center, I do not know another church in our conference that's been able to make this transition in the way we have. So a thank you to Jen and to the committee and to everyone who has helped us do this. What is happening now is, if you want to look at it right now, well, if you got your phone with you or in your, or when you go home on your computer, we are today launching a new website. It will look different. It was built on the past in a wonderful way. Russ Shatroma, who left us for the Church Triumphant 5 years ago, was the one who initiated this. And as I'm looking back over the minutes and that Carolyn Turnbull offered up, it was back when Jim Durlester was your pastor, and those some of you here remember those days. He helped share this idea, and then it was passed on to Carolyn in, looked like 2008, and so for 12 years she's managed this website so that we could be in this new moment, right? We build here, literally and figuratively, we build on our past here so that we can be the people of God known as Stone Church in this building and online. So today, again, with built on the past and looking to the future, you can go check out, and please do, look at the new website and check out what you can find there. It is still at the address that we began with, stoneumc.org. Jen is going to be available in Miller Parlor after this worship if you have questions. She is also going to, excuse me, help you and me as we manage the change. So we will, you're not on your own if you're someone that's like, I don't even know anything about apps on phones or websites. Don't worry, we're in it together, and we are going to, again, build up the body of Christ here and online. So that's what's going on. Please check that out. It's a good day to be together. Hold on. I may need a glass of water. I'm going to probably need a glass. We're sending Jen. Not only does she do online ministry, she will get me a glass of water. I meant to do that ahead of time. So here we are. Here we are, all of us together, called into this place again, wherever we are, because we know that we're compelled by God's love to be disciples. To be disciples, to be neighbors. This morning we move from last week, won't you be my neighbor, into this month where together we will be exploring what does it mean to be a neighbor and who are our neighbors. We do so always remembering the love of God and the call of Christ. So all of that behind us. Let's breathe in God's presence in this place and wherever you are joining us from. Breathe out any of the stress of this day that we might be present to this time of worship. So I ask now for us to take into our hearts, as we take into our ears, the hymn, His Name is Wonderful. Jim. His name is wonderful. So as we come into this time of prayer, lifting up our joys and concerns, this morning, I didn't mention in the beginning, but the beautiful flowers on the altar are given in memory of Tyler Learn by his family. So this day, as we come into time of prayer, we do remember everyone who's lost a loved one, especially those who've lost children. We know that never goes away. It is not a sorrow that you put aside. So we pray for those who grieve. We pray for those who are dealing with addictions, whether themselves or someone in their family, somebody they love. We know the burden of that. We pray for those in recovery, in rehab, who are working very hard at sobriety and cleanness and wellness. And I'm thankful that this church has opened back up to our recovery groups, because we know that's vital. We pray this morning for a couple, Brian and Cindy, whose names came to us through Facebook, who are in West Virginia, who are dealing with health crises and concerns, so we lift them up. And we remember always that even when we don't know these people personally, God does, right? So we lift them up. This day, we pray for those who are now not only dealing with COVID-19, but are dealing with the storm that's coming up the East Coast, and all those live in places of danger. This morning, we continue to lift up those who are challenging and facing systemic racism. And we pray for the courage to confront and deal with our own racism. I didn't know whether I was going to share this or not, but I, over the summer, have been standing with those on the diamond with Black Lives Matter. And so that means one thing or the other to any of you. But on Friday, when we were standing out, we were harassed. There was a man who first drove by these people, just standing, literally standing, holding signs, and was yelling. And then he parked his truck and got out and circled around behind us and yelled at us and called us names. And we really want to be better than that in Meadville. I keep thinking that. Whatever is going on nationally that we feel like we have no control over, I really believe we can be better than that, that we can honor each other, we can respect property, we can stand peacefully. Even when we don't agree with one another, we can remain community members. So I pray. I pray again. I just pray that as disciples of Jesus Christ, that we can honor the Christ in each of us, even when we disagree. So I lift up that situation to all of you this morning as we move forward as a community. So with all of that, we know that God hears us and knows us. So we listen now with our hearts and our ears as Jim plays, "Lord, listen to your children praying." God, thank you for listening to us when we pray. Thank you for hearing our concerns, for knowing our sorrows, for listening to us when we cry out in anger. Thank you. Thank you for knowing us and loving us just as we are. When we make bad decisions, when we turn away from one another and from you, for always welcoming us back and offering forgiveness, for your ongoing willingness to set us on the right path, for seeing us as we are and for wanting more for us. Oh God, thank you for listening to us as we pray. This morning, we thank you for new life of this season. We thank you for Chris Lambert's new grandson, Eli, We pray for him and his family that he might grow in health and well-being. Oh God, we thank you this morning for families who have felt so much support during times of recovery and grief. We thank you, oh God, for binding us together, even when we're apart. Even when we're apart. Thank you. Thank you for those who are caring for our loved ones right now in care facilities. Thank you for those who are working for cures for COVID-19 and vaccines and so many other diseases. Be with those who are going through treatment right now for cancer and for other diseases. Oh God, again, thank you for listening to your children praying. We know we have broken our covenant with you. We know there have been times when people have looked at what we have done or heard what we have said and didn't see you in us. We know that breaks your heart. And so we offer up our forgiveness and ask that you would set us back on your path, back on the path of Jesus, who showed us how to live and love courageously, even unto death. So in his name, in his peace and power and presence, we pray to you now with the words he first taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So earlier I talked about how our website is built on the past. And I think maybe in some past life, this book, the story told by Jesus, the Good Samaritan, must have been part of some of your kids' Sunday school classes here. Because when I first arrived, we must have had 15 copies of this specific book, which made me think that it was shared in a different sort of way than we did now. But this is the story for this morning. So if you're small and medium-sized people joining us via Armstrong Cable or Facebook, gather around the rest of us, pay attention because you're going to hear this story now and then again. The story of the Good Samaritan, and actually nifty, you can't see, but it's got these cool, you know, that kids love this, these cool little foldouts. So it goes like this. One day Jesus told the people around him that everyone must love their neighbor as much as they love themselves. And one of the people asked Jesus, who's my neighbor? And Jesus answered by telling a story. A man traveled from Jerusalem to Jericho along a lonely road. Some robbers were waiting behind a rock to rob people who were passing by. That's the nifty behind the rock part. When the man reached the rock, they attacked him and stole his money and all of his belongings, and then they ran away, leaving him badly injured and without food or money or even his donkey. After a while, a priest passed by. The priest was afraid the robbers would come back, and he did not help the wounded man. And then another man came along, but he looked away and quickly walked past without going back. Finally, a man from Samaria came along. He saw the wounded man and stopped. People were often saying bad things about Samaritans. It was a little bit worse than that, I'll tell you later. But the man from Samaria stopped and helped a wounded man. Then he put the man on the back of his donkey and he walked beside him all the way. And when they reached an inn, they stopped and the man from Samaria took care of everything. There he is in his bed. The next day, the Samaritan had to go on. He then asked the innkeeper to look after the man and paid him in advance for everything. And then after this story, Jesus asked the people around him if they could tell him, now, who was the good neighbor? And the Samaritan was the good neighbor. It taught the people they should love their neighbor regardless who it is. Let's see. Oh, there's a couple kids looking on in. The Samaritan was the good neighbor. We'll talk a little bit more about that Samaritan in a bit. The Samaritan was the good neighbor. Jen is now going to offer us a piece of music called I Will Lift My Eyes. So we think about who we lift our eyes to and what the call is on our life.
Thank you. you.
Lift our eyes to the Creator and the one who loves us. We come to worship because we believe that there is a God who loves us, and again, who wants more for us and for the whole world, not just us. Well, this morning, like I said, we are continuing, or I guess beginning, this August theme of looking at who is our neighbor. The first scripture comes to us from Deuteronomy. It is part of what our Jewish brothers and sisters refer to as the Torah, known very well to Jesus. These are words Jesus, his disciples, and those around him treasured. So I read to you from Deuteronomy chapter 6. I'm actually going to read verses 1 through 9. This is Moses speaking on behalf of God. Moses says this now to the Israelites. Now, this is the commandment, the statutes, and the ordinances that the Lord your God has charged me to teach you, to observe in the land that you are about to cross over into and occupy, so that you and your children and your children's children may fear the Lord your God all the days of your life, and that you will keep his decrees and commandments that I am commanding you, so that your days may be long. Hear, therefore, O Israel, and observe them diligently, so that it may go well with you, and so that you may multiply greatly in the land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has promised you. Oh, hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God and the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Keep these words that I'm commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you're at home and when you're away and when you lie down and when you rise up. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead and write them on the doorposts of your house and of your gates. The Lord alone is our God. So these would be the words that were known by the scholars and the Pharisees, Jesus and his disciples. So the gospel lesson, which you already heard in the children's sermon, is the parable of the Good Samaritan. Jesus has been in a conversation, so to speak, with a group of leaders. And we're told this in Luke chapter 10, beginning with verse 25. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, well, what is written in the law? What do you read there? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you've given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, the lawyer asked Jesus, well, who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him. And when the Samaritan saw the man, he was moved with pity. And he went to the man, and he bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. And then he put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, the Samaritan took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper and said, now take care of this man, and when I come back, I'll repay you whatever more you've spent. Now, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? And the lawyer replied, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, then go and do likewise. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Go and do likewise. It's Seems easy for you to say, Jesus. It's hard for us to go and do likewise. So open us this morning to this story, not only as a story, but as instruction, commandment, guidance for our lives. Open us to your word. Amen. Last Sunday was a fun Sunday as we celebrated the witness and work of Mr. Rogers. After the service, I had a text message from my daughter, Leanne, who had joined us for worship on Facebook, and she said, "Mom, your high school theater teacher would have been so proud of your opening." Which was true. Mr. Roberts would have been very proud of it. Right? In that singing, though, "Won't you be, could you be?" And then it goes, won't you be, please won't you be?" And at the end, you're like, "Stop it. Yes, I'll be your neighbor." There's something about Mr. Rogers that is very endearing and probably to some just a tad annoying. Most of us, though, loved Mr. Rogers, and in part because we feel very safe with him. I mean, sure, you want to be his neighbor, right? Mr. Rogers with the sneakers and the zipper sweater. And also, if you didn't like him, you could just turn it off. You could just turn it off. Now, here's the thing about this biblical question about neighborliness. At the end of that passage I just read, it said, "Go and do likewise." There's something deeper about what this has to do with being a neighbor. Now, that parable that we just heard is so familiar that it almost verges on a cliche. People who've never, you know, read the Bible nor heard this parable per se know what a good Samaritan is. There are such things as good Samaritan laws that are to protect bystanders who intervene on the behalf of someone that they perceive as being injured but is a stranger to them. I saw a news story earlier in the week from Burlington, New Jersey, and the opening of it read, "Police in Burlington Township praised the actions of two Good Samaritans who stopped and pulled an unconscious motorist from a burning vehicle shortly before it was consumed by flames on July 26. These two men, Larry Scott and Dominique Golden, were just passing by when they saw a car smoking and the man in the driver's seat had had a seizure of some sort and was unconscious. And they went to the car not knowing this person and they pulled him out right before the car burst into flames. Shout out to Larry and Dominique, who we do not know, but thank you for being good Samaritans. That seems to be the point of this story, this parable, to go out of your way for another, even if you don't know them. But there must be something more to this story, or Jesus would have told it in a simpler way. Because he could have just told the story that there were three men who passed by, an injured man, two of them didn't stop, one of them stopped, he saved his life, yay, right? And then the moral would be, you know, always help another. But why add in then, why did Jesus put in that third man was a Samaritan? And why is he called good? It's funny, in that children's book I read, it says because people said bad things or not nice things about Samaritans. It was way worse than that. There was a huge racial and religious divide. The Jews and the Samaritans were enemies. It went way back to the beginning of the kingdoms of North and South in Israel. And so when they heard this word, one article I was reading about this said, it'd be like if you had heard Al-Qaeda was, that's who that third person was. It was your enemy. It's the enemy who becomes identified as good. The good Samaritan. As Jesus, the story is set up that Jesus is, and we didn't read all of it before, but Jesus is headed toward Jerusalem, and he stops in a village, and he gets into this testy conversation with a lawyer. And the lawyer is not a lawyer as we think of. He's not one that settles property or custody disputes, but a lawyer, when we read in Scripture, is a one who's an expert in the religious law. Again, this is one who knew the Torah. He knew in his head, if not in his heart, what he was supposed to do. So the lawyer is pressing Jesus. At first, it sounds like, it says he's pressing him, he's testing him. But then when the lawyer asks the question, I think this is really important for where the story goes. We're told that the lawyer asks Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" And the reason he asks it, we're told, is he's asking in order to justify himself. To justify himself, to prove that he was right. To prove that he was right. To prove that he was chosen, to prove that he was good, to prove that he was saved, just like he was. And that the way he believed and the way he was acting was justified by law. In that case, from what he knew, that the only neighbors that you had that were qualified to be your neighbor were Israelites, were people just like you. And so if that's the case, then you go, okay, love your neighbor, love people that are just like myself, good, check mark, I am justified. And then, of course, Jesus, as he so often did, goes on to tell a story. His answer is hidden in the story. The man robbed, left for dead, to pass by, a priest and a Levite, everybody hearing that story, and the lawyer would all say, well, we know those are good people, right? It'd be like if I told you me, the pastor, and our district superintendent, and our bishop all walked by, and you'd be like, well, they're good. We know that because of where they fit in the religious order. That's what we're hearing. So these two that you expect to be good do nothing. And although our kids' book gives reasons for why they pass by, we don't know. And there's some conjectures on that. But then this third shows up, this one who is the enemy. This one who is the enemy. And we're told that he was moved with pity. He was moved with compassion. That will give us an insight into why he does what he does. And so he goes out of his way, and it's quite detailed into how he ensures that this harmed man will recover. After the story, Jesus says, what? Who is my neighbor? His answer to who is my neighbor is the story. And at the end, he says to the lawyer, now you tell me who was the neighbor. And the lawyer, who can't even make himself say the word Samaritan, says, the one who showed him mercy. Go and do likewise. So many places to look for ourselves in this story, in this parable. Maybe you have been one beat up and left by the side of the road, in one way or the other. Maybe you've been made fun of. Maybe you've been excluded. Maybe you've literally been harmed. You felt like the one at the side of the road. Maybe on a good day, you felt like the Good Samaritan. Maybe on a bad day, you felt or acted more like the priest or the Levite. What I struggled with this week was an honest assessment that I'm so often a lot more like the lawyer who asked the question. I want to be justified. I want to know the right answer. I want to know that I am the one who's been following the rules, that I'm the one who does the right thing. Seems like maybe what Jesus was pointing out to the lawyer and was pointing out how much that lawyer may have been like the priest or the Levite that walked on by. Maybe. Maybe you, or maybe it's just me here, sometimes feel a little righteous. We call it being self-righteous. Times when I've been more concerned with protocol than with people, when I've been more calloused in my response to another than compassionate. And then along came a Samaritan, someone unlike myself, someone for whom I was not expecting, and I saw them show pity, share compassion. I wonder, what about the Samaritan in this story, and what about good Samaritans that I've known and encountered? Why? Why? Why when the other two who seemed, again, so righteous, so in the know? Maybe, just maybe, it's because this one Samaritan knew what it was like to be the one in the ditch. Maybe that's why he responded. There was a professor out of Princeton University, Dr. Robert Wuthnow, who did a research project. I always love research projects, so some of them point out things that are quite obvious, which I think his did. He did a big study on what makes people generous and compassionate. Generous, compassionate people. Why? What is it about them that makes them different from maybe someone who isn't? And not surprisingly, the vast number of persons who are compassionate, who by their actions could be identified as compassionate, were people who had had the experience of someone showing compassion to them. They had been the person in the ditch, and someone, a teacher, a neighbor, a parent, a cousin, an aunt, an uncle, a sibling, a stranger, a coach, an aide, your bus driver, your coworker, someone else reached out to you or to me in our very lowest moment and gave us help, gave us encouragement, were willing to sit with us, stand with us. The person who came and was in the emergency room with you when you already told them you don't need to be here. Or the person who gave you $5 when you were standing in the grocery store line and you didn't have enough cash. Or the person who remembered that your loved one had died and they were willing to say his or her name. Or that stranger, you know, I've told this story so many times, but it's so perfect for this, I have to tell it again. The person when I was flying with our daughter, our first child, and I was flying on an airplane in the middle of winter to my roommate from college's wedding, and I was on this jet blue in a hangar of a waiting room. It had just bathrooms that were open, no little places to change your baby. And I had a baby who needed a diaper change, and I'm a new mom, and she's crying. And that stranger that I never knew her name laid her winter coat down on the bathroom floor so that I could change my baby on her coat. That's a good Samaritan. That's a story about one who went on her way. I mean, she was also, by the way, flying with this coat on. So those are the people. Those are the actions in our lives, I think, that make us, that create in us the capability to be that third person, to be that Samaritan. When we recognize that someone else has done that for us. And you know, every now and then I have someone that I encounter who said, no one was ever there for me. I was always on my own. And I can't dispute that. And about that story, then I would also say, then would you want another living human being to ever go through that? No. Then be that neighbor. Be that neighbor. So in times when I feel self-righteous, when I feel like I'm a self-made person, when I feel like my religious or political or social positions on anything or everything are right and others are wrong, I have to take a deep breath and look back at this story and to ask if I could walk by or if I could go close because I don't know what another person's story is. I don't know what has made him or her who they are. I'm not the judge. I'm not to be self-righteous. My righteousness, as Scripture tells us, is always in Jesus Christ. So the invitation from this story, the command, right, it says go and do likewise, is to be moved by compassion to do something, whatever that something might be. To remember a time when one has come to you and to be thankful. And to offer ourselves to another. So after telling the story, Jesus asked which of these three was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers. And the lawyer responded, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said, go and do likewise. We will. Amen. Amen. So how will we reveal ourselves to a world who needs to know Jesus? They'll know we are Christians by our love. So I'd invite you to stand as Jim plays for us this spiritual. Send you forth with the last verse of that song. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, God's only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Amen.